Hello, child of God. I have a personal dilemma that I'd like to discuss with you, and it has nothing to do with money. I have a pet dog that I love, but it's causing me a lot of problems. The mutt is part chihuahua and part terrier. The name of this crossbreed is taco-terrier. I received the dog as a young puppy, and he's now around 3 years old. The dog has very bad anger issues and bites anybody around him when he's angry. For example, roughly a year ago, I was driving with my 90-year-old mother in the passenger seat. The dog was trying to get out of her lap and into my lap while I was driving, and my mom gently tried to keep him away from me. In a flash, he became an angry, vicious dog, snarled, growled, and snapped, and almost bit my mother's fingers. Now I know why we hear about those horrible people that throw dogs out of moving cars. I flashed into anger myself, and if I could have reached that mutt, I would have tossed him out of the window at that moment. Yes, in that particular instant, I would have been one of those horrible persons that throws a dog out of a car moving at 65 miles an hour. Splash! No, he's never been an abused dog. I love this dog, and most nights he sleeps with me. I play with him and treat him as nice as any other person treats their own pet dog. I had him neutered last year to try to calm him down a little, but now I can't really tell the difference because he's just getting worse. He's bitten me and several other people recently, and when he started snapping at the grandchildren, I knew that he was beyond my ability to manage him. I recently found two different nice homes for him, but eventually they sent him back to me because of his anger and his biting. And now I'm in a situation that I'm harboring a vicious dog that eventually will bite one of my visiting grandchildren. I'm a responsible parent and a grandparent, so I cannot allow a pet to threaten my children. The permanent answer to this dilemma is just to have him put to sleep, which also corresponds with what the Bible says about how to deal with vicious animals. But then at home, I become this heartless villain in my wife's eyes, whom also loves the mutt. Not to mention trying to explain the missing dog and why I had him put to sleep to my grandchildren. Many times in the past, I've asked the Lord to teach me spiritual things from some of the things that I see in nature. And as I speak about the dog, he is now resting in his favorite place, laying between my knees. And I'm still wondering just how to handle this problem and just what is Almighty God trying to teach me about this unpredictable mutt with his anger issues. Has my pet fallen into the hands of an angry owner? Or have I exhausted all of my options for the protection of my grandchildren and I just need to man up and have him put to sleep, no matter what my loved ones think of me? As I face this dilemma, I look at my own actions and wonder, am I falling into the hands of an angry God? Or has he just exhausted his options and is leaning toward putting me to sleep after sending me many warnings to repent? But look, let's project this lesson into the entire world and wonder if the entire world is falling into the hands of an angry God, or has God exhausted his options and must judge the nations no matter how it makes him appear? God is the ultimate irresponsible parent and cannot allow a vicious people to threaten his own people. In some of my videos, I point out the anger of Almighty God judging the wickedness in this world. But that's only a small part of the entire issue. The Lord Jesus Christ is soon to return and rule the earth in peace for 1,000 years. But before that happens, the vicious dogs of this world must be put to sleep. Every rebellious neck must be broken. Therefore, most of the world's population has to die. And mankind, in general, will resist, shake its fist, and curse Almighty God. Christians and Jews will be blamed for the world's problems, and most of us will be killed. We could just easily sum up God's reasons for giving us the end time prophecies, giving us the judgments in Revelation, showing us Daniel's 70th week, showing us the mark of the beast and the battle of Armageddon, to this conclusion that the entire world is falling into the hands of a holy God that is angry because he has exhausted all of his options and is forced to judge the nations of this world no matter how it makes him appear.
And this shall be the plague wherewith the Lord will smite all the people that have fought against Jerusalem. Their flesh shall consume away while they stand upon their feet, and their eyes shall consume away in their holes, and their tongues shall consume away in their mouth.
And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, A measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth.
Almighty God can see Satan totally defeated and being punished in the lake of fire. The Lord Jesus Christ defeated Satan on the cross, and now we must each defeat Satan with the blood of the Lamb, the words of our testimony, and die in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is, to love the Lord Jesus Christ more than we love our own life. The Lord Jesus Christ spoke to each of us concerning these end-time events in the New Testament book of Luke.
Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man.
The instructions the Lord Jesus Christ gave us is that we should pray that we are able to stand before the Son of Man. My friend, no one is able to stand before the Son of Man unless he is washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. There are none righteous, no, not one. We have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Let us pray now together and ask Almighty God to forgive our sin and wash us in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just follow after me in prayer, but pray with your own faith and your own sincerity. Father God, that's right, just pray in faith after me. Father God, I ask you now to forgive all of my sin and wash me in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and make me holy unto you. Baptize me now in the Holy Spirit and give me more power to resist temptations. I acknowledge that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for my sin and is soon to return. I forgive all of those people that I have resented or hated, and I receive from you the free gift of salvation. I dedicate my life and commit my spirit to you. I ask you now to keep me strong in the time of testing and help me to stand before the Son of Man. I receive that as done. Amen.
Thank you for praying with me, child of God.